You can start.
Good evening and welcome to this monthly talk of Tamil Heritage Trust. For those of you who are new to Tamil Heritage Trust, or THT as we call it.
You can start.
I have started, I thought.
Yeah.
Go on, please.
Tamil Heritage Trust organization that is based in Chennai here. With a vision to promote and disseminate Indian heritage. We are a bunch of volunteers who are active in the area of heritage.
Just continue, Shyam.
Yeah, sorry, I think I'm getting some feedback here. I'm just cutting off. Yeah, my apologies. Yeah. So we connect a number of different types of programs in the area of heritage. For example, we take people to Mamallapuram under a program called Malai Study Tour, which is a study tour conducted by trained docents. We have an educational program called How to See a Temple, where participants are introduced to temple architecture, iconography and epigraphy, and then they're taken to an actual temple to quickly see what they've just learned in the classroom. We have a similar tour for museums. We have a program called Pechu Kacheri, which roughly translates to talk concert, which is done during the Chennai's famous Kacheri season, a concert season in December, when we have a seminar, a two-day seminar with about 10 to 11 talks on a particular theme of historical and heritage importance. We have a program called Site Seminar, where a limited number of participants prepare and then go and visit a specific set of monuments across the country. We've done site seminars in Madhya Pradesh and Gujarat and Orissa, and of course many places in and around Tamil Nadu and Karnataka. But our staple is this event, which is the monthly talk. Every first Saturday at 5:30 p.m., Tamil Heritage Trust has a talk by an expert or an enthusiast on a wide range of topics in the area of heritage. It could be art, architecture, history, archaeology, and so on and so forth. This has been continuing since 2009, and many of our earlier talks can be seen, the videos can be seen at our website, tamilheritage.in, where more than 100 talks are available on a wide range of topics. This particular talk, this monthly talk, creates a little bit of history for us, because this is the first time that the monthly talk, the speaker of the monthly talk, is not actually present in Chennai. While the last two monthly talks were also done online, this is the first time that the speaker himself is outside of, physically outside of Chennai. And who better to take us into this digital world and to create a little bit of history for us than our speaker of this evening, who has himself been harnessing technology in the service of heritage communications in the most effective and well-celebrated way in Delhi. So I'm delighted to welcome Vikramjeet Roop Rai, who is an author, educator, historian, and an activist who has developed creative ways to teach conventional subjects. He started researching Delhi's heritage in 2009 while he was still an IT professional and an entrepreneur. He then founded the Heritage Photography Club to promote Indian heritage through travel and photography. In 2015, he left his digital marketing career and turned full-time into an educator. He established what he calls the Heritage Shala, where his team sets up heritage labs in schools and develops programs for corporates, teachers, and students so that they can learn through events from history. He has been instrumental in setting up and managing a website called monumentsofdelhi.com, which documents every single with an ambitious target of documenting every single monument in Delhi. He has been an auditor for UNESCO, the Aga Khan Trust for Culture, and the Education Quality Foundation of India. He has delivered 5 TEDx talks so far, and 3 of which revolved around his favorite theme, which is the theme of education system of India. He's been invited to speak at events in IITs and IIMs, and is currently a visiting faculty at the National Institute of Fashion Technology in Delhi. Vikramjeet was listed by India Today magazine as a change maker of Delhi. Hindustan Times and Outlook Traveler has ranked his portal as among the top 10 resources for Delhi's heritage. Times Now and Economic Times have recognized him as a good crusader. There's a lot more to Vikramjeet, and you can read all about him and his wide range of initiatives and achievements at his website, vikramjeetdesk.com. We'd like to thank Vikramjeet for so readily and promptly accepting our invitation to deliver this talk today. He will speak for about an hour, and after that, he'll be happy to take some questions. Those of you who want to send in your questions, please type in your questions into the YouTube chat box or on Facebook. The questions will be read out by my colleague Badri at the end of his talk, and he will take the questions after that. So I'm delighted once again to welcome Vikramjeet Rooprai, and I hand you over to him. All yours, Vikramjeet.
Thank you, Shyam. Thanks a lot for such an elaborate introduction, and I'm honored to be on this platform. I've been talking to people since the lockdown has started. We've been doing so many webinars, and every time I get on, get in front of camera and pick up a topic to speak, I realize that even I need to learn a lot more. There is so much curiosity amongst, especially the audience that I interact with, that encourages me to find more stuff, do more research, come up with more interesting content. So, today, the topic that I'm going to talk about is Baolis of Delhi. I spent about 10 years doing my research on Delhi's monuments, out of which 5 years were dedicated only to the stepwells or the Baolis of Delhi. And I realized that a major portion of India, people don't even know what a Baoli is or how it looks and how it functions. So I thought, why not? And since the water problem these days is at its peak, so why not talk about something which is actually required, it's a need of the hour. And when you say water, how exactly was water managed 100 years ago, 500 years ago, 1000 or 2000 years ago? Water pits or these water tanks, we have found these references in Mohenjo-daro and Harappa, all these cities of Indus Valley civilization. If you have to find some common element amongst all these cities, then two or three, four elements were: one, you will always find a water tank in the center of the city, and in many cases multiple tanks. For example, if you go to Dholavira, there were dozens of tanks, only three have been excavated so far, and one of them is three times bigger than the great bath of Mohenjo-daro. You go to Mohenjo-daro, there are multiple tanks. You go to Surkota, from that to down south, wherever you have sites of Indus Valley, you have these tanks. Cities which do not have a water tank or the other elements, like a proper, fortified city and all, those were just considered as trading posts and not a proper city. So water management, be it sanitation, be it water for bathing, be it water for drinking, how did they manage the water? That, in a way, became one of the core elements to understand a city of Indus Valley civilization. And since those days, we have been storing and using water in very beautiful ways. Unfortunately, over a period of time, we forgot the old ways of managing water. We moved to new ways, which is actually a good thing. Development is always required. But in this process of development, there were some key elements that we always had, which somewhere were lost with time. And perhaps in today's presentation, I'm going to talk about those. So what is exactly a Baoli and how it functions? Let me start with that. Baoli is simply a subterranean structure to fetch water from underground aquifers. Now we know that there are rivers or channels of water under the ground, and there are two kind of water channels. One is the confined aquifer and one is the unconfined aquifer. So the unconfined aquifer, or the upper layer, is basically where the rainwater is accumulated, and then there is a proper regular water channel, which we sometimes also refer to as the water table or the underground water level. So in order to fetch that water, if you create a straight shaft, it is called a well. And if you create steps to reach the water level, it's called a step well or a bauli. Bauli is known by many names. You go to Gujarat, it is known as Vau. In Delhi, in central India, it is Bauli. Go to Haryana, it is Bavadi. So in every, you go to Karnataka, it is Pushkarni. Every area, it comes with a different name, but the concept remains same. This is a simple diagram explaining the functioning of a bauli or the structure of a bauli. So what you see over here, the well, what people used to do was, they would identify the spot where they have to dig up. So they would keep a wooden frame on ground and start clearing mud from within that wooden frame. Slowly as they clear the mud, they would start pushing that wooden frame downwards, and as the wooden frame is pushed down, they would create additional layers, maybe wood, maybe bricks, so that the wall doesn't collapse. So when a well is created, basically they are this is how. So they would keep a wooden frame over here and start digging in, and side by side the wall is being created and the frame is being pushed downward. Once they reach a level which is the actual confined aquifer or the underground water table, they would clear the ground in such a way that it fills with water. Now usually this process is done when it is not the raining season, which means there is no water over here. There are no rains, this portion is dry, and you only have water over here. So that's when the wells are dug up, and once you reach here, you get a proper cavity where the water is filled. They would fetch water, throw it out for a few days continuously, so that a large cavity is created, which is continuously filled with water. And as the rain comes, because the moment you throw water outside, water will seep back in and start filling this particular channel. And as soon as the rains come, this channel will fill. There are already water channels created, and then you have your unconfined aquifer also filled in. Now, this is how they would construct the well. Then they realized that when you have a larger village, a lot of people living in there, a simple well will not suffice. So they needed a bigger space where people could actually go to the water level. They don't have to fetch so many buckets out and then take to the place where they want to. They needed water for bathing, for washing, for drinking, all kinds of chores. So what they did, they started creating steps. They created steps, and they would create steps and then form a tank, and they would take it to a level where it can get water from either the unconfined aquifer or from the well. The beauty of this whole thing is that the tank never penetrated the confined aquifer directly. Now, if you look at a simple principle of physics, which says pressure is inversely proportional to surface area. So we have lesser surface area, which means more pressure. We have larger surface area, which means less pressure. So the water can travel from this direction to this direction. From well, water will come into tank or the basin, but it can never go back. Which means that if you are washing, if you are bathing over here, this water gets dirty and all the dirt gets accumulated over here. It never mixes into the well directly, and it never pollutes the confined aquifer. So these kind of small things, what I found when I was doing my research. Then I also found out that there were customs around these water structures, be it a step well, be it a well, be it a tank or a pond, that during morning and evening time men could use structures or these water bodies, and in the afternoon the area was reserved for ladies. So if a man comes near a water body, a tank or a well or anything of that sort, that person will not look towards the water structure. He would rather stand in a way not looking towards it and make some sort of noise. He can cough, or he can bang a utensil, or maybe call out to someone, make some sort of noise, so that if there is a lady using the water, she should get alert and she should know that there is a male presence over there. If there is a lady, she can tell that person to please wait outside, or she would fetch the water, or someone from, because they were usually coming in groups. So someone from the group would bring water to this person, or they would say that, okay, we are decent, you can come forward, you can take water or whatever you want. Or if there is no one, nobody replies, then this man is free to go near the water. So this was sort of etiquette that when I was doing my research in Haryana, Punjab, this belt, I could see that this etiquette is still followed in many of the villages. Another interesting thing that I found out was that people were told not to bathe in this water on certain days, not to wash their hair, not to wash their clothes on certain days. I tried to figure out, and the only logical conclusion I could get was that when you wash your hair or when you wash your clothes, there are certain types of plants that you use. For example, amla and shikakai that you use while washing your hair, which can leave a greasy layer or an oily layer on the water. And if someone is washing clothes at the same time, that oily layer can be a problematic thing for the person washing clothes. So they said, okay, on these particular days, let us not wash our clothes. And on these particular days, let us not wash our hair. On these particular days, we will not do this. On these days, we will not do this. So as to the, you know, keep the water safe, not pollute it, and nobody ever touch the base of a well or a tank, because that's where all the sludge or you know, the dirt gets accumulated. And if you touch that, the dirt comes up, mixes with water. You have to leave that water still for a few hours so that everything settles and you can start using water from top. And this is not something, though my research or the book that I've written focuses on Delhi's step wells, but this particular thing about step well I found standard, or not just step wells, any kind of water body is standard across the globe, that the tank, and you know, over a period of time you need to clean the tank basin, the base of the tank, the well, so that sludge is not accumulated and the pores from which water actually falls in, they are not clogged. So desilting, regular desilting is also required. Maintenance of these water structures is very important. One more thing I found out when I was working on the step wells of Delhi, that the orientation of all the bawlis or all the step wells, there is a very unique phenomenon amongst them. Most of the step wells are from north to south. As far as the direction is concerned, the steps lead from north to south. There are examples like the Old Fort or the Purana Kila and the famous Ugrasen Ki Bawli. So if you have seen a PK movie, in PK movie, Amir Khan uses Ugrasen Ki Bawli as his residence. So this Bawli became very famous. Now this Bawli has steps leading from south to north, and the Old Fort Bawli has got its steps leading from southwest to northeast. In both these cases, the roof is covered, the tank is covered. So there is a roof on the tank. And in all other cases, where the tank is open, direction is from north to south. The reason for that is India is a northern hemisphere, and the sun moves from east to west. So coming to an area like Delhi or maybe even Haryana or Punjab, where you also find these kind of phenomena, sunlight comes at an angle and the tank has to be in the deeper position. So if you keep the tank on the southern side, you don't have to cover the tank, and sunlight will be blocked with a huge wall which is behind the tank, which is also you know, the well is behind the tank, and that will block the sunlight, which means sunlight will not fall directly on the tank, water will not heat up, water will not evaporate, and due to which the temperature and the water level in the tank was always lower than outside. So they started building rooms around the tank where people could walk, step down, go and sit in those rooms, spend their summers, afternoons. And there are cases in Delhi where people started living in them, you know, permanently. So those kind of cases are also there. This particular thing holds true for Delhi and some portions of Haryana and Punjab, but not across India, because everywhere, given the geography and given the requirements, they kept changing the design. They adapted it to the local requirements. For example, if you go in Rajasthan, you'll see that many step wells are square shaped, and there is no separate tank and separate well. Well is the tank, which again changes when you go to Gujarat. So in Rajasthan, like you go to Chand Bawri and all these, you have steps leading in from all sides, and these are very steep because water level is way too low in the desert. So they had to make much deeper step wells. They won't make very wide, they would rather make a small step well, but a very deep one. So sunlight would anyways not reach the water level. So that problem is solved, and they would create steps from all sides so that people can comfortably go down. Now these kind of things, you will find this variation across the country, and step wells are mostly in this South Asian region, more prominent in Indian subcontinent. But we do have a few examples in Europe as well as in a few other countries where they would simply put simple steps inside a well, so that if anybody falls in, he can come out, or maybe you can go down to the water level. So some very few examples do exist. People often ask me whether can we revive the Baulis or not. We have got a list of 32 step wells in Delhi, 32 Baulis, and out of which only 16 are currently open to public, out of which I think 10 or 12 have water. Out of these, only 3 Baulis are such from which water is actually being used, 3 or 4 Baulis. But that water is being used only for the irrigation purpose. Can we revive a step well anywhere in India? It's quite difficult, because a step well, the most important thing for a step well is for the rainwater to reach the underground water table. What have we done with our cities? We have got those concrete jungles, we have got well carpeted roads, metal roads, and huge buildings on both sides of the road. So if there is a rainfall, water is either falling on the roof of the building or on that metal road, from where entire water goes into our sewage system, from where we are pushing that water to a nearby drain, which goes into the river and then to the sea. We don't allow water to seep into the ground and recharge the water table. The only solution is to create water recharge strategically across the entire area, which will definitely solve the water problem also. Our step wells and our wells are natural recharge, natural in a way that we have constructed a structure, but down under it is just a recharge pit. So even if we can start filling or start directing all the rainwater into these wells are interconnected, and these step wells or Baulis are interconnected through underground water channels. If we redirect all the rainwater to these wells and Baulis, it will actually affect the water table of that entire area. And we have seen that example in Delhi, where one of the Baulis was cleaned, revived, and 3 Baulis near that place got their water back. So it is possible, but it requires political will. You need to fight with land mafia, and you know, a lot of structural change is required, because there are so many structures that are built, many legal, many illegal, but there are complications. And like I said, political will is a very big thing, and of course, the land mafia. So that's what is the biggest roadblock in the case of revival of a Bauli. Let me talk about those Baulis which are remaining in Delhi right now. One is Firoz Shah Kotla. So Firoz Shah Tughlaq, who is also called the father of irrigation system of India, he built this step well in the palace that he constructed in Delhi as his capital. It's a circular Bauli. This is an old drawing from early 1900s when the British started studying it. This is how it used to look. It doesn't look like this anymore. It's you can see this picture. The domes on top are now broken. There used to be a roof on this. It's all gone. This is the only circular structure that we have in Delhi, which is a water structure. There used to be fancy steps and railings and balconies. It was a palace in itself with rooms and everything. All that is gone. This is how it looks now. Very recently, they have put a metal grill because someone was trying to walk on the edge and fell inside the tank. So tank is the well in this case. There are 2-3 Baulis where tank and well are not separate in Delhi. This is one of the functioning Baulis. You can see these ugly pipes which are going in, fetching the water and sending water to the nearby, the lawns of the palace, whatever remains of it. That's the lower level, the second level, steps leading. And then we have these pillars holding the entire structure. This is not too far from Yamuna, the river, and they had a proper drainage system connected with Yamuna. So if there is excess water inside this step well, it would go into the Yamuna, and through Yamuna they would filter the water through sand naturally, and the Bauli would get filled. So all that mechanism ASI was able to dug up. Next one is inside the Red Fort, again by Firoz Shah Tughlaq. This Bauli is expected to be 300 years older than Red Fort, which means the Red Fort of Delhi was constructed around this step well. It's again from Tughlaq period, L-shaped structure. You can come down from north side or from the west side. There's a tank and then there's a well on one side. Another functioning bauli, and there are underground chambers which during the British period were converted to a prison. I'll come to that. This is how the stepwell looks. Somewhere in the Lodi era, it was reconstructed probably because the kind of masonry work that we see, the kind of cutting, fine cutting of stones that we see, this is not a Tughlaq era work. And the kind of design that we see over here is not a Lodi era work. So probably the bauli existed much before the Lodi kings came in. But when they saw the structure, they just repaired it. And when the Mughals came in, they constructed their palace around it, and they designed it in such a way that this bauli became part of the palace. The British made this floor by putting girders and some pipes so that you can walk over it and you can see water under it. So over the well, they have constructed this floor so that if anybody wants to walk, they can. That's how it looks. And these are the prison cells. So what happened in 1945 after the World War, soldiers of Indian National Army were captured, and three generals leaders of Indian National Army were actually brought to Red Fort, Gurbakhsh Singh Tillo, Shahnawaz Hussain and Prem Sehgal. In fact, at that time in 1945, there was a huge cry within the city of Delhi. There was a slogan that was given, ki Lal Kile se Uthi Awaz, Sehgal Dhillo Shahnawaz. For these three brave soldiers of INA, they should be released. But they were kept in this stepwell. The arches, the British quickly installed these bricks and grills. So this was converted to a prison. And then over here, they had put long girders, metal girders, and created a floor on this. So nobody knew that there is a stepwell under this. It appeared to be like steps coming here, and then you just go here, and then these their rooms inside, there was a toilet, a makeshift pantry so that food can be served to these prisoners. Then there is another fort behind Red Fort, which is the fort of Salimgarh. Inside that Salimgarh fort, a new prison was constructed. These three prisoners were moved to that, and the famous Red Fort trials, if anybody's interested, you can search about the Red Fort trials that happened inside the Red Fort, where Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru and many of these big names were the lawyers of these three soldiers of Indian National Army. Those Red Fort trials happened. After independence, 1947, these three people, they were freed, and earlier Archaeological Survey of India decided to convert this particular room into a museum. But then they found out that there is a problem of snakes and a lot of insects because you are already underground. So instead of using this chamber, they created a museum in the Salimgarh Fort, which is now under renovation, and they are moving it to one of the barracks of Red Fort. So if you have been to Red Fort, you have seen that there are multiple barracks. And last year, a lot of changes have happened to Red Fort, where some structures were removed, which were constructed by the Indian Army, and only the structures by the British Army and the Mughal era, they were kept intact, and most of the British barracks have now been converted to museums. So we have multiple museums depicting a lot of things, be it 1857, be it 1945, and be it other independence movements of India. This is quite an interesting thing in the Red Fort bauli. The well has a wall with arches on sides. Under one of the arch, it's a very small structure, you can't go inside. So you have to stand outside and just watch from there. In one corner you have a temple, in one corner you have a grave, and they're just side next to each other. So this appears to be from the Indian Army time, because after independence, Indian Army took over. So it seems that during their time, this thing was installed. But it's quite fascinating. Just two arches next to each other, one containing a grave and one containing a small makeshift temple. And because still some soldiers live in there, they come and they pray over here. Then we go to a place called Ridge, Delhi Ridge, where the Aravallis end. So we have the Delhi Ridge, and in Ridge we have a stepwell again from the period of Firoz Shah Tughlaq. And this one is special because in most of the records I found out that there was a tunnel from this Ridge bauli to the another bauli that he had, which is the first one that I showed, the circular one. And right now, this Bawli is under the premise of a hospital called Bada Hindu Rao Hospital. So Hindu Rao was a cousin of one of the Marathas, and he purchased a house over there, and in his courtyard, he had this Bawli which was kept intact. That's how the Bawli, the layout of the plan of the Bawli is. This is Pir Ghaib, a structure or an observatory of Firoz Shah Tughlaq, which stands right next to this Bawli. And on the right side, you can see an old British style house, which was the house of Hindu Rao, which became the Hindu Rao Hospital. And behind that, the huge building, which is the present building of the hospital. And this one has been converted to a medical college. This is basically the office of the examination cell. So that building still exists. And when I first visited this Bawli, it was in this shape. This particular photograph is from 2011. That's how the Bawli looked. And now this is how, after restoration, the Bawli looks. This is one of the cleanest Bawlis that I have seen. The green layer that you see on water is not dirt. It's basically because of those that plant, the entire ecosystem of this area functions. You can have fishes because those fishes would survive on these green plants, and then migratory birds would come here who would survive on those, feast on those fishes. So the ecosystem or the food cycle works because of that. It doesn't stink, it is not dirty. When I walked down, the water was quite clean and I could see pebbles in the base of the tank. Where exactly is that tunnel? We don't know, because we have got records that when British found that tunnel, they sealed that tunnel. But this is the only arch that is available, so there is a possibility that somewhere over here should be the tunnel. After 1857, British actually sealed a lot of tunnels in Red Fort, Old Fort, and all the forts that we had, and all the step wells, the havelis that we had in Delhi, because through these tunnels, and there was such a complex grid of underground tunnels that people who were revolting, the rebels or the mutineers or anybody who wants to harm the British, he could go through these tunnels, hide, run anywhere, pop up from any corner and harm the British. So they deliberately sealed all the tunnels that we had in Delhi. One somehow was left, which we found a couple of years back under the city town hall in Chandni Chowk. And there is one which exists under one of the offices of, I think it is a railway board, Railway Engineers Office, Northern Railway. Under his office, a portion of the tunnel survives. They have sealed it from two sides, and whatever portion remains is their storeroom right now. Then we have one of the most sacred Bawlis in Delhi, which is the Bawli of Khwaja Nizamuddin Aulia, in the shrine of Nizamuddin. This is how it looks structure-wise. On the right side, you have the top view. On the left side, you have a side elevation where there are buildings and domes on side, and you have steps leading right to the tank, which is also the well. So not all Bawlis have a separate tank and separate well. In many Bawlis, tank and well are the same thing. This is how it looked back in the days of between 1902 to 1919. We've got many paintings and pictures from the British era, because this is one of the most visited step wells and well maintained, because pilgrims are continuously visiting this place. And this is how it looks these days. Now let's go to one of the most famous Bawlis, which is the Agrasen Ki Bawli. People started connecting it with Maharaja Agrasen. Interestingly, when we write Agrasen, we often spell him as A-G. But in this case, the spelling starts with U. So when I was working on my book, the spelling thing actually bothered me a lot. So I went to, you know, many scholars, tried to find out. Then I picked up some old books, I did my research, and I found out that this spelling is actually how locals used to pronounce it back then. Because what British did, British always write phonetic sounds. So if you go to Kanpur, now these days, in case of Kanpur, we write K-A-N-P-U-R. But back in the British days, if you pick up any British document, you would read the spelling as C-A-W-N-P-O-R-E, Kanpur. So they always used phonetic sounds and they converted to alphabets, and that's how this also comes. Because here, back in those days, earlier dialect, we used to call him Maharaja Ugrasen and not Maharaja Agrasen. So that was quite interesting thing. So in my book, I have dedicated one page just to the nomenclature, that how this name shifted and in what all books, in what all records, how it appears in maps, how it appears, because there are so many different spellings that I found in all the documents that I've read. One of the old pictures of this place, there are steps inside the wall. So walls are quite thick and there are steps leading up and down inside the wall, and also the main tank, the boat that's over there. This is how you enter inside the wall and then you use the steps in the main bowli. So that's how this used to be filled till 1970s and even 1980s, early part of that. But now it's completely dry. There's a small mosque also in one corner. Okay, now let's move to another one, which is called the Munirka Bauli. There is a village called Munirka in Delhi, and when I read about this Bauli, I went to this place, Munirka. I started looking for the Bauli, couldn't find it, spent many months searching the entire area, no documentation, nothing. And then one day I found a record which said that during the period of Prime Minister Indira Gandhi, a major portion of the land connected to Munirka was taken to construct government residences, and that area was renamed as Ramakrishnapuram or the RK Puram. And early before that area was considered as an extension of Munirka. So then what I did, I picked up my car, I went to RK Puram, started exploring that area, and I found this tiny Bauli with five huge tombs. And this one is quite an interesting structure, because you have a tank, there is a well behind it. You have two minarets or two turrets on the top, which actually have winding staircase within. So you can use this staircase to walk, and then there is a corridor in between. This corridor that you see is actually this one. On this side you have the well, on this side you have the tank. So this structure is there. It's a very nice small structure and quite peaceful. And the well has winding staircase also inside. So different places we get to see different styles, different architectures. Now one interesting thing is, this is the step that lead within the turret or the tower over here. These are the steps. One interesting thing is this water channel or the aqueduct. Now what happens is, a person would stand here, fetch water and throw water on the side, on the edge of the well. That water will automatically come down and come through this aqueduct, and people, the villagers would line up with their buckets and pots and fill the water in their buckets over here. So this was quite a nice arrangement, where only one or two people have to go on top of the well to fetch water, and they just have to, or maybe they can use a Persian wheel, where they can have a big wheel connected to an animal through pulley system. Wheel keeps moving and there are cups connected to a belt which is on that wheel. Cup goes inside, fetches water, comes back, throws it into a shaft or an aqueduct, and that water is transferred to this aqueduct. So a simple system used at many places, even today in many cases in fields and all. So that's how they were using water over here. This is the oldest stepwell in Delhi, the oldest Bauli, built by this king called Altamash, Samrat Altamash, successor of Qutbuddin Aibak from the slave dynasty of Delhi Sultanate. It's one of the oldest and also one of the deepest, not the deepest, but one of the deepest Baulis in Delhi. I've seen it completely empty, I've seen it completely filled. People still go there, and when this Bauli was dug up, they found out that there are traces of sulfur in the rock beneath this whole structure, that piece of land. And the water that came up was not fit for drinking, but this sulfur-rich water was good for many kind of skin diseases. So this Gandak simply means sulfur. So this is sulfur stepwell, or the stepwell of the sulfur, Gandak ki Bauli. And people still, even today, come here, take a dip. The Bauli, when it was completely dry, there at that time it was usually kept locked. Now the water is back, they have opened it. But recently some accidents have happened, and the police has sealed this Bauli for some time. The water right now is not very clean, because it has started fetching the groundwater of Mehrauli, the oldest city of Delhi, which has got all the sewage mixed in it. So water is dirty, water is stinking, but people still think that this is magical water. It has got all those magical properties to cure your skin. So they still come and take a dip. This is one of the old photographs which I've got from University of Tokyo research of this temple. That's how Delhi used to look back then. And this is not too old, this is 1960s or 70s. As old as 1970s, hardly 40, 50 years back. The first picture is of this temple completely dry. And the last picture is, I think from last to last year when it was filled up and locked. Then we have a stepwell in Old Fort. This one is also very interesting because Old Fort is considered to be the land where the Pandavas of Mahabharata fame, they used to have their capital, and there's a huge mound. Many excavations have happened on that mound, and archaeologists have found so many things dating back to the Gupta period, the Kushan period. We've gone back, we still have to find anything connected from the period of Indus Valley civilization. But I'm confident that we will find it, because in this entire belt we have done many other excavations and we have found so many things. However, on the huge mound, there was a fort built by Sher Shah Suri and later Humayun, who strengthened that fort. Akbar also did some work over there. And after that, a village came up and these people started living in there. Now, village was already existing, because from 2nd century records, Claudius Ptolemy, this Greco-Roman mathematician who came to India and who created this map of the world, he mentioned Indraprastha or Indraprastha. And Indraprastha is the city that Pandavas built. And this village was still there. Even today, the metro station that is connected to this place is called the Indraprastha metro station. So, you know, people were living, and when British came, they tried to remove all these people. They cleared the village, they gave them money to re-establish, and they just moved the village out of the fort and they started restoring the fort. There was a garbage dump where the entire village was throwing all the waste they had. When the garbage dump was, they started clearing, the British, they kept going on and on deep inside, and they realized that it is actually a stepwell. When they cleared everything, water came back and this Bauli was revived. So this is how the Bauli now looks with water, and this was all filled up with garbage of the village that was existing there for several centuries. This is how it is now. Again, water is not very clean, so it is only used for irrigation of the lawn. That's inside the old fort. Now, this one is quite interesting. It's called Rajon Ki Bauli, and one of the most ornate stepwells of Delhi. If you know, I often ask people, why Rajon Ki Bauli? What does Rajon mean? And people come up with ideas like, this must be of some king, because Raja means king. This is not Rajon Ki Bauli. This is Rajon Ki Bauli. So it is not a Bauli of a king. It is Bauli of a mason. Mistri, because in northern India, the masons are also called Raj Mistri. So Raje or Raj Mistri, these people were actually living inside this Bauli, and all the arches that you see on site, they seal these arches with mud bricks, and in some of them they kept windows, and some of them they kept doors, and they converted all these arches to their rooms. And a group of Mistris or the masons was living inside this stepwell, and that's how it got its name, Rajon Ki Bauli. That's the structure. We have this stepwell, and there is a mosque and a tomb connected to it. Tomb of the guy who built it, Daulat Khan was the person, the governor of Ludhiana, who came here and built this structure. This is how it looked in 1908, 1919 and 1923. In all the British records, you will find that this Bauli has three levels, because during the British period they couldn't excavate it further. But now that when ASI was trying to restore it, they found out that it has a fourth level also. So this is how it looks. And in this picture from 2011, you can see four levels. And this year, see, this is a picture from January. It is completely filled. All you can see is the top level, which is above the ground, rather partially above the ground. 2017 we had three. So every year after the rainfall, the level of water changes. This is one of the baulis in which water returned after a nearby bauli was restored. There's a mosque connected to it and the tomb of the person who built it. You can see traces of blue tiles, and there are a few other tiles which are, you know, colors are all gone. Minor traces remain. So this must have been a very beautiful structure back in the days. Then there is a very small, tiny, the smallest bauli of Delhi called the Lohar Hedi bauli. There used to be a village called Lohar Hedi. Now it is Dwarka sector 12 of Delhi. And a very tiny structure, just two, three levels. When I first visited in 2012 or 13, I saw it like this. It was very difficult to identify the place. And then government decided to restore it. And this is how it looks today. Tiny structure, but serving the purpose for a small village. And this one is another interesting stepwell, which is called the Arab Sarai Bauli. So Arab Sarai is the area connected to Humayun's tomb in Delhi. People often come to Humayun's tomb, which is a World Heritage Site. We have only three World Heritage Sites in Delhi. We've got Qutub Minar, Red Fort, and Humayun's tomb. And when people come to Humayun's tomb, they don't even realize that something of this sort also exists within the premise. It's a very small structure. It used to be an underground structure with a mosque on over it, but that whole mosque thing is now gone, and the steps and the well is now exposed. The upper portion is all broken. And last year only, Aga Khan Foundation has restored this bauli. This picture is from before the restoration, when ASI had earlier restored it. Now Aga Khan has done a much better work and brought it to a much better shape. This is the last one in my list. It's the last bauli ever constructed, because after this, the British came in, and when the British came, they did not construct any further baulis or wells. They rather focused on laying the pipeline. So they had pipe water, they introduced the sewage solutions. So all that came in. It's inside the complex of the shrine of Khwaja Qutubuddin Bakhtiar Kaki of Delhi. So in India, we have multiple families of the Sufism. One of the families or one of the orders is the Chishtiya order, the Chishtiya Silsila, which starts with Khwaja Moinuddin Chishti of Ajmer. After Khwaja Moinuddin Chishti on his seat, sits Khwaja Qutubuddin Bakhtiar Kaki, whose shrine, this is where this bauli is situated. And after Khwaja Kaki, we have Baba Farid, very famous poet. His Bani also in Guru Granth Sahib, so he's also revered by the Sikhs. After Baba Farid, we have Hazrat Nizamuddin Aulia, another famous shrine in Delhi, Khwaja Nizamuddin. And after Nizamuddin, we have Hazrat Chirag Delvi Sahib, another shrine in Delhi. So the five pillars of Chishti order of Sufism in Delhi, in India, three of them are in Delhi, Khwaja Kaki, Khwaja Nizamuddin, and Khwaja Chirag Delvi Sahib. This one is from Khwaja Qutubuddin Bakhtiar Kaki's shrine. And that's how the bauli looks these days. It's dirty because it's locked for people, but there is an opening towards the well side on one corner, and people don't know what's behind it. Some people think it's just a garbage dump, and there is often, you know, because so many pilgrims come to this place, and those who travel to Ajmer Shrine, to the shrine of Khwaja Moinuddin Chishti, they often first come to this place, and from here they do their complete their pilgrimage to Ajmer. So this entire area is always crowded with people. You will have langars going on, the feast, and whatever these people are eating, they would throw garbage into what they think is a pit, but it is actually a bauli. And the water level that you see is right now 40 to 50 feet, which is roughly 4 to 5 stories of a house. That deep is the water level that you see right now, and I'm already 3 to 4 stories deep standing at the water level, and it is further 40 to 50 feet deep. Old girders, pillars from the British era. So when we say British era, the Mughal emperor was still the titular emperor. The British had taken all the control, and hence the British influence in this structure. Even the girders that you see, you can read Glasgow 1898. So this girder was installed a little later, when they were restoring the Bauli. There's also a Bauli in the port of Tughlakabad. They say that there are over a dozen Baulis in that area, but only two survive, and they're in a very bad shape. There is a debate whether it's a Bauli or just a tank, because it is on a hill and it is not deep enough to penetrate the ground level. But then we don't know what kind of water level was back then. And we also know that there used to be a lake outside this fort. It's a huge fort. So is it a Bauli or is it just a simple tank to store water, rainwater? We are not 100% sure. Okay, I'll quickly touch upon this one also. There is one completely cordon off sealed Bauli inside Old Delhi area called Mathia Mahal, and this is the only view you can get from a small window. So I have my mentor Sohail Ashmi Saab trying to click the picture of the Bauli. When he stepped aside, I also stepped forward, I clicked this picture and I got this picture. So this is the only thing that you can see. There are buildings, there is a mosque over it, there is an entire colony over this Bauli. And there are pipes which are fetching water and supplying water to this locality. But nobody knows that it is actually a Bauli under this. So that's the Bauli. We have got a huge list. If you are interested in the complete list, it's available in my book. It's also available online on my website, Monuments of Delhi. And I also have this presentation, easily accessible there. And what I'll do is I'll also compile this list separately. Put it somewhere, just the list of Bauli, so that people can easily access. So these are the 32 step wells of Delhi that were recorded in 1910, and out of those, hardly 16 survived. Thank you.
Thank you.
Badri, you are on mute.
Yeah, thank you, Vikramjit. I have a few questions that people have asked. One question is there any difference between Baulis and stepwells?
Bauli is when I say in Hindi of Delhi. So Hindi also has multiple dialects. When I'm in Delhi, I would call it a Bauli. But if I have to speak in English, I'll say a stepwell. That's it.
Okay. So there is basically no difference between them.
The language.
Okay. Fine. Again, there is one more question which says, I believe there are 100 Baulis in Delhi. Is it true? And if yes, how many of them still survive?
There is one document that I also found which said there are over 100 Baulis in Delhi, and that document is way too old to be, I don't think even that person went and counted. So it was more of a metaphorical thing. In 1910, the Archaeological Survey of India prepared a list which was done by Maulvi Zafar Hassan, who was the superintendent archaeologist of Delhi for ASI. He prepared a list of 32 step wells, which I have just shown, and you can find it on my website also. Out of those 32, only 16 survived. Out of those 16, only 6 have water, and out of those 6 or 7 that have water, I think 8, around 8 has got water, but only 3 Baulis are such from where water is being used properly.
Are all these Baulis open for public? Can anybody visit them?
Not all are open for public. Baulis inside the forts, they are trying to open them for public, but there is a big risk because the Bauli that I've shown of Khwaja Kaki, Darga, I am already 40 feet underground, and then there is further 40 feet of water or 50 feet of water. If someone falls in, it's very difficult for that person to survive.
Okay.
And we have actually lost many kids in last 3-4 years in Gandak Ki Bauli, in Firoz Shah Kotla, and there has been an accident in Red Fort also. So it has become important for government to keep these temples closed. They're way too deep.
Okay. A whole host of us from Tamil Heritage Trust, we had visited Gujarat and visited some of the temples. Of course, the Rani Ki Vav is a different class of its own. But in Ahmedabad, we went to Adalaj, we went to a few other places.
Patan.
Patan Rani Ki Vav, I'm just skipping. But just looking at the stepwells of Gujarat, we can see that they're significantly different. The Gujarat ones are almost, all of them following pretty much the same model. Whereas the ones that you have shown here are like wide variation in them. Any views on them?
One thing we need to keep in mind is that the stepwells in and around Delhi were built by the kings who were either Muslims or who were under the patronage of Muslim kings. So whatever they constructed, they had some sort of ideology or the architectural style from the Islamic traditions. Whereas in Gujarat, you will see figurines, you will see the kind of motifs and patterns which are native to Gujarati culture. So there is a big difference in the ideology for the people who were constructing these structures.
Okay.
But the physics remain same. The physics and the science, that concept of sedimentation, that when you mix water with sand and you leave it for 5, 10 minutes or half an hour, sand will settle down and you have clean water, filtered water on top of it, which is also called sand filtration.
Okay.
That is the thing which happens across the globe if it's a well.
Okay. One of the question is, have you researched on Baulis of UP and Haryana?
Well, I have seen them. I've seen quite a few. But when you say research, research is a big word. I haven't reached that stage where I would say that, yes, I was able to find proper information to a level of writing an article or a book. I haven't reached that stage.
Okay. Okay. Stepwells of Gujarat Vows have multiple entries and are also classified based on it. Are there any such classifications of Baulis?
Yes. Unfortunately, very less academic work has happened in case of Baulis. But in older days, when you talk about Vastu Shastra, it does mention a few things, where how to construct a building, and depending on the geography, depending on the weather, all these things did matter. It's a pity that we do not have the accurate information as of today. And when I went on with my research, I tried to talk to those people who were digging bore wells or wells these days. And I asked them, how do you identify where exactly to start digging? They were not ready to share that information.
Okay.
And they confirmed that it is not written anywhere. It is something that is passed from generation to generation, and it stays within that community. So this whole notion of holding on to information has actually worked against us. And we have lost so many logics.
Okay. There is one more question on this you have already answered, but anyway, I'll ask this one. Did any of these Baulis have any artistic representation, as in sculptures, paintings, or records, as in inscriptions, which you answered?
In Delhi, we only have inscriptions.
Okay.
In many Baulis, we have inscriptions, which are, except for one, all inscriptions are gone. But somewhere in history, we were able to record. And you know what? When I was trying to do my research on these Baulis, I realized that no information, proper information, is available in English. So I had to learn Urdu and I had to learn Persian.
Okay.
Because a lot of records are available there. In fact, today I was working on my next book. So I was just reading one of the books, which
okay.
is, this is one volume. I've got three such volumes, which is just the list of monuments in Delhi.
Okay. Yeah.
And, you know, even the small bookmark doesn't work in this. So I'm using a metal scale here.
Okay.
My other bookmarks are not working properly in this book. So in these, because some of these books were written in 1800, that's where those inscriptions, when they were still existing, they
okay.
mentioned those inscriptions and calligraphy.
Okay.
So that's where I found that information.
Yeah. One question is, what would be the best time or period to visit all these places? This was also asked by another person earlier. And to what is the max allowed depth, that is, when the water levels are the lowest? So how far can you go?
It's difficult to tell the water level or predict the water level, because right now, since the water is not being used, it depends on what kind of silting has happened, if the pores are all clogged and water is just, maybe there are three Baulis just next to each other in Maroli. Sometimes two of them have very less water level and one is built completely to the top because there is no place for water to seep out. So there is no particular time. If you come in the rainy season, yes, you will see the Bauli completely filled. If you come in the month of May, June, when we do, although these days also we are getting occasional rains, but usually during these periods, these months, water level goes down.
Okay. Are all these Baulis in some sense connected underneath to some aquifers, or, you know,
yes.
has there been any study on that?
Underground, naturally, there are underground water channels, what
okay.
we call the river under the layer of earth.
Okay.
And these channels in some or other way are interconnected.
Okay.
There is a possibility that all the Baulis across a certain plateau or a certain plate, tectonic plate, probably are connected to each other.
Okay. Okay. There's one question which is, no Baulis in Delhi tourism. What does he mean by that? I don't know. Only now I come to know. Does he mean that in the Delhi tourism booklet, no mention of any Baulis?
Delhi tourism booklet does mention Bauli,
okay.
But Delhi tourism booklet is very small. Delhi has got 1317 monuments, 1317.
Okay. Okay.
And this book is the smaller version. I'll show you the bigger one. This is volume 2,
uh-huh.
This is volume 3, and volume 1 is even thicker. This is just a list of those 1300 monuments.
Wow. Wow.
Around 750 or 800 survive today.
Okay. Okay.
It's not possible for any government to prepare a booklet with a list of 800 monuments.
Okay.
So what they do is they only mention the very prominent ones.
Okay.
And probably that's why the Baulis get a miss.
Okay. There was another question which was that why there aren't any Baulis or Steppels in the same numbers in South India?
Because the kind of water structure, see, in Delhi, we had scarcity of water. Water was not readily available.
Okay.
And we did not have rivers flowing through Delhi. There were only one or two channels which were also depending on rain. So for a village to survive, and since so many people were coming and trying to make this city as their capital, and new cities were being built, traders from all over the world were coming here, they had to fulfill their need of water. So Baulis was the only option left.
Okay. So one more question is, steppels are associated with some Devi temples, while Baulis seem to be associated with mosques. Is that really true?
No. What you are saying is, let me say it in English, steppels are associated with temples, and steppels are associated with mosques, because Bauli is steppel.
Yeah, exactly.
So it all depends on who. Now, in case of Agrasen ki Bauli of Delhi, there is a mosque, but we have found records that it was built by a Hindu trader who came from Agrawal community.
Okay.
He named it after Maharaja Agrasen, but it is still a structure by a Hindu where he also built a mosque. So it's no big deal. There are so many structures where Muslims built temples.
Okay.
There are examples where Hindus built mosques.
Okay. Very interesting. Actually, the fact that there are such complex structures built around drawing water, you know, one could have simply said, a big well and then some kind of pulley mechanism or whatever it is. But then it wasn't left at that level. That a phenomenal architecture was developed around that. And in multiple states, starting from Gujarat, Rajasthan, Delhi, Haryana, Uttar Pradesh.
I think you should start from Afghanistan. You have starting from Afghanistan, going down to Karnataka and even Tamil Nadu and all.
Okay.
We have steppels everywhere.
Yeah.
Even near Mumbai, we have a steppel.
I see. Okay. So actually, it will be a nice idea to put together a Google map with
steppels.org by Philip. Philip is a very good friend.
Okay.
He lives in Europe.
Yeah.
But he was so much fascinated by steppels, so he created a site, steppels.org. Philip Ayres has already mapped all the steppels of this planet.
Wonderful, wonderful. So that's that's another new fact which I should follow. What is the name of the book that you display? Urdu book, the volume 2 and 3, I suppose.
Yeah.
Are all the books that you have displayed, you could talk about them.
The book is Waqiat-e-Darul-Hukumat-e-Dilli by Bashiruddin Ahmad.
Okay.
This is one book. Another book which is older than this one is Asar-us-Sanadid by Sir Sayyid Ahmad. But there is a problem with Asar-us-Sanadid. This is rather a compact book. The version that I have now, what Sir Sayyid did, Sir Sayyid went into the city, started talking to people, and whatever stories they told, he wrote it. So this book is more of oral traditions, and this book is filled with archaeological facts.
Okay.
So studying both the books together made actual sense when I was doing my research.
Okay. There is one query for getting hold of your book. I suppose it should be available in Amazon, Flipkart, wherever.
And I think Amazon is also giving good discount. It should be. So otherwise, the price is $399. But
Okay.
on Amazon, it is somewhere around 300 or 250, 270 something.
Okay. So all of you listening, the book is available. You can just search for it in Amazon and get hold of it. Of course, there are, you know, I only asked you questions, but in the live chat, there are people who are, you know, praising you, you are knowledgeable, all the other things which you fully deserve. It was absolutely captivating and trying to understand something which, you know, I have visited Delhi many times. I don't know, I mean, more than 100 times for certain. But I haven't seen a single Bolis. I've of course been to all the various Mughal monuments and you know, the other places which Delhi is you know, sort of literally littered with places. But never realized it. Even after my trip to Gujarat, where for the first time I saw some of the steppers, I didn't really feel like looking out for something like that in Delhi. So that deserves, when everything settles down and you can visit Delhi.
And I'm sure you can find some, maybe not in Chennai, because Chennai has got such a lovely beach. You don't have that kind of scarcity of water that you need wells and step wells. However, let me share one more interesting fact. In Delhi, four of the step wells are or were constructed within a 500 meter radius of Yamuna River.
Okay.
Now, 500 meter is not, I mean, quite a, sorry, not just 500 meter, even less, 200 meter, sorry, 200
okay.
meters.
Okay.
Now, if your river is just 100 or 200 meters away, you don't need a well or step well. You can walk to the river also, 100 meters or 200 meters.
Exactly, very true. So, why were they doing that?
I found out that this is something told to me by the director of Namami Gange project.
Mm-hmm.
That there is a certain type of isotope of oxygen in Ganga and Yamuna that you cannot consume Ganga water and Yamuna water on a regular basis, on a daily basis. So this sand filtration actually clears the water and makes it fit for human consumption on a daily basis. And that is why in certain cases, like in case of Humayun's tomb, Yamuna touched the wall of Humayun's tomb.
Mm.
And still we have three wells inside from where you draw the water. You don't get it from the river.
I don't know whether I can say it has something to do with isotopes and from that angle, but certainly it can work as a filtration, river water versus a filtered well water, I'm sure would make a lot of difference. But wonderful. Thank you. Thank you, Vikramjit. It was an outstanding talk, and we really enjoyed, you know, I was switching between, you know, your video and the screens that you were showing, the animated, you know, passion with which you were presenting the talk. So on behalf of Tamil Heritage Trust, we thank you and you know, we wish you all the best. And you seem to be doing too many things, you know, in terms of documenting the monuments. That's an outstanding activity. It's one of the things that we as an organization here, we would like to do it here in the region that we are working in, and we will take inspiration from you. Thank you. Thank you from Tamil Heritage Trust once again. Thank you. Bye bye. One second.
I'll leave the meeting.